Hi everybody, I'm Bill Whittle here with Steve Green and Scott Odd, and this is your right angle on the launch of the Falcon Heavy booster, which happened just a few moments ago. We recorded it live, we weren't able to stream it live, but I mean, honestly, it happened 10 minutes ago. We were watching the whole thing, watched the replay, so we're fresh off of this. I told you guys this would be an unmitigated disaster. I told you this thing was a catastrophe. Didn't I say from the beginning that this government subsidy of Elon Musk is just going to lead us down the road to ruin and blah, 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 blah. No, it was without question the most impressive thing I've seen since the first shuttle launch, and maybe the most impressive thing I've seen since the Saturn V. Scotty, I hate to put you on the spot with this, but just the second before we rolled tape, you said something I just thought was so wonderful about what you felt after this launch here.
Well, it's the second time we watched the recording of the landing of those rocket boosters, which if you haven't seen it yet, is two rocket boosters coming down, landing on side-by-side landing pads, standing straight up. And there was this immediate image in my mind. It was as if somebody stood the World Trade Center towers back up again. It's how it makes you feel about the country. It's a recapturing of glory, in a sense. Not that we can ever erase the past, but it is that image of America standing tall, and the inherent goodness and innovation and possibility and promise.
Yeah, and by the way, that's exactly what did happen today. They did stand those towers back up again. That's not just, I mean, that is exactly what happened. So, guys, needless to say, it was beautiful and spectacular. We've cut some footage together here. We have about a half an hour version of us actually watching the launch live and so on. Steve, you know, there's what was your favorite moment? I mean, everybody talks about the dual landing because it was so spectacular. But when we were watching it live, I know all of us, Steve and I, especially because we knew the reference, when you saw this red sports car in space and then you did the reverse angle and on the navigation screen it said, "Don't panic."
For whatever reason, my feed was about 3 seconds ahead of yours and Scott's, so I saw the "Don't panic" on the nav screen on that Tesla Roadster, and I blurted it out. I didn't know if either of you would get the reference, but Douglas Adams, one of the funniest and science fiction satirists, I guess would be the right way to describe him. The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, the fictional book within the novel, has the words "Don't panic" printed in large friendly letters on its cover. And the cheekiness of putting that on the dash of that Tesla that is on its way to Mars with a mannequin wearing a SpaceX spacesuit this is our Barnum. You know, the three of us spent two or three segments gushing over the Greatest Showman. Well, we have a new Greatest Showman, don't we?
Yeah,
we do. Scotty, is your lights off? You look a little dark to me.
Have I gotten dark? You know, maybe I'm a little
dark.
Don't
worry about it. I just thought we'd brighten you up.
I'll see if I can brighten myself up a little bit.
Yeah, that's better anyway. Thank you. I was going to talk about the whole showmanship thing. That's basically what I wanted this segment to be about. But as
I didn't mean to step on that. I'm sorry.
No, on the contrary. I'm glad you brought it up. I find myself at a loss for words, having just basically blurted out a few hundred thousand of them during the actual launch. So it's hard to actually, do it. But it was. I'm reading from their website here. The most powerful rocket to launch in 45 years since NASA's Saturn V, which last flew in 1973. Hmm. I thought we'd be seeing what we just saw somewhere around 1976 or 1977, something like that. And I've waited a long time for this. I'd like to just repeat what we mentioned in the live thing, and this is a triumph for America, needless to say. There's not another country in the world that's done this. The Russians haven't done this. The Chinese haven't done it. The Europeans haven't done it. And the Americans haven't done it if you're talking about governments. But this was the most American thing I've seen in my lifetime, I want to say. I really think it was. Even more so as I've gotten older and given some thought to this whole idea about what makes this country work. Apollo was the essence of what we had in us as a resource of people. You know, it was like one of the best thing I ever heard about the Apollo program was from one of the engineers or astronauts who basically said that the Apollo program, in order to make it work, we had to reach 50 years into the future for technologies that we didn't have and procedures that we didn't have and just try and bring them back. And they did. And they did it, you know, they did it six times and they brought everybody home. But what we saw today is not just a triumph for America. It's also a triumph for humanity. I'd like to say this as clearly as possible. It is an enormous triumph for the millennials that I have spent a lot of time denigrating for their, you know, for their work ethic and you know, emotional frailty and so on. My hat is off to every single one of those people there. Most of them look like they're in their late 20s, early 30s. And you guys have done something that the people that I thought you would look like, you know, the guys with the clip-on ties and the short white button-down shirts with the pocket protectors, you've done something they haven't done. You put them up and you brought them back. But I think for me certainly, you could talk about the triumph of the human spirit, and I don't want to pee on anybody's parade, but it wasn't human spirit that did this. It was human spirit coupled with free enterprise. It was human spirit coupled by a vision. You can't. There's this view we're looking at now, just as the replays of the booster going up horizontally. It looks like the Starship Enterprise. That doesn't happen just because of the human spirit. That happens because of the human spirit. It happens because you happen to still live in a country, despite the best efforts of many people out there, where you can, in fact, go out and do things. This is the product of wealth. This is the product of success and hard work. And this is, of all the things I've seen in my life, the most compelling evidence of what free people can do with free markets in their own time, on their own dime, following their own dreams. So I'll just close with the thing I thought I was going to open on. Yes, go ahead, Scotty.
I was just going to say, can I throw in two other elements that we...
And I'd like to when Scott's done.
We need filler.
We sometimes underplay these in the United States, but it's due to two other factors that for a long time were unique to the United States of America. The first is the sanctity of property rights.
That's exactly right. This is mine.
That you can own this. The guy who's developing a technology can own it for a period of time. It's exclusively his, and so he's willing to pour in the resources because it's his resources at the risk, and he doesn't have to worry about the government or anybody else stealing his property. And if they do, there's legal recourse for that. The second is bankruptcy. And I know that sounds weird, but it's the opportunity that this country provided for people to take tremendous risks because they knew that if the worst happened, they wouldn't be ruined forever, that they would have an opportunity to restart, that this is a land of second chances. And I know that sounds like a negative thing to say, but it's an absolute positive when you look at the kinds of risks people have taken. And in some cases, if you look historically, many people have actually been through bankruptcy and then went on to later success. The possibility of a fresh start in this country is like unto nothing we've seen since a man hung on a cross in Jerusalem.
Steve, I'll come to you in one second.
Sure.
I just want to say one thing about what Scott just said. I talked about it being a testament to free enterprise. It is also a testament to the idea of corporations and to this idea that so many people have a problem with the idea of a corporation as a legal person. There's an old saying in aviation, you know, how do you make a small fortune in aviation? Well, you start with a large fortune. And this is exactly what Elon Musk has done. There's no way this business is profitable yet. You know, it may never actually be profitable. But the fact that Elon Musk could form a company called SpaceX and put a significant portion of his wealth into it, and if it failed, then he would lose what he put into SpaceX, but he wouldn't lose everything. He can bet the farm, but he doesn't have to bet his life. If he had not had the ability to have that kind of corporate legal structure where it was his money, and if something exploded, every single penny he had in the world would be gone, he wouldn't have done it. No one else would either. And that just needs to be said in a world where these whole things are just kicked around repeatedly. This is what a group of people functioning as a legal person can accomplish. They can own the future. Stevie.
Yeah, just a couple of quick things. One, you talked about the millennials. I will bet you in that control room, yeah, filled with millennials, great kids, amazing kids, and I bet you there is not one Tide Pod eater among them. And the other is just a little more serious. This actually happened a couple of weeks ago, but I somehow missed the story. I just saw it this morning. And that is Rosie the Riveter passed away at the age of 96.
When? Today?
No, I just saw the story today, but it actually happened about 2-3 weeks ago. And, of course, they ran the poster with the story, "We Can Do It." And I just...
We can, if you leave us alone. If you just leave us alone,
That's right.
This is what we can do. But I have no doubt whatsoever that we saw some people tweeting already that this was, you know, how come this is what NASA should be doing? Well, we gave them 40 years, folks. And I'm a guy who've said 100 times that the NASA vector tattooed on the inside of my skin. But NASA's not NASA anymore. This is NASA now. This is the spirit. This is the spirit of Apollo. This is it. This is Apollo right here. This is what it's all about. And as I said during the live thing, you know, we feel it's our moral obligation to constantly come out and talk about what usually is bad news. Standards are falling and erosion of freedoms and loss of liberty and loss of virtue and all the rest of it. There's some life in the old girl yet, you know. There surely is. Elon Musk succeeded here because he was willing to fail. During the Apollo 13 crisis, Gene Kranz, the mission flight director, was legendarily quoted as saying that failure is not an option, that we're going to bring those people back. And that was the right attitude to have in that situation. But Elon Musk has famously said that failure is an option here at SpaceX. If we're not failing, we're not innovating enough. We look at the successes here, and we need to look at all the explosions. We need to look at all the time we saw that beautiful, breathtaking dual landing of the liquid boosters coming down. It's mind-boggling. But those boosters came down and looked so beautiful because of all the times they came down and tipped over or missed or almost got it or just about got it. You have to fail in order to succeed. Elon Musk understands that. SpaceX understands that. We understand that. And America has always understood it. And like I said, there's some life in the old girl yet. The whole thing I was going to talk about today was showmanship. I'm too blown away to talk about showmanship other than to say this. I have said on many occasions, every now and then we do a story about a guy who builds a jet-powered outhouse or something along those lines.
Yes.
And people mock that, but I am as serious as I can be. It is the playfulness of it that made this possible. We had a national mission to go to the moon. We were in a fight with the Russians and so on. Elon Musk, I am convinced, it's self-obvious. When you decide to launch something that could have been just, you know, 15,000 pounds of dead weight, and you decide to launch your car company's, you know,
your
red
own
convertible
car
with an astronaut playing David Bowie's Space Oddity, it becomes clear, and he's making it clear with the don't panic sign, that Elon Musk is doing this because it's fun.
Yep.
That's it. He's doing it because it's fun. And the same for Bezos and all the rest, and Branson. These individual people are doing it because it's fun. And it is kind of fun, isn't it?
It is.
It's a great day. It's a great day today. For everybody here at BillWhittle.com and your right angle team, I'm Bill Whittle here with Steve Green and Scott Ott on a historic day. And I think one of many that for the first time in my life, I think after today, I actually genuinely think I might actually live to see. And I think the three of us might live to see it together. And when that first foot goes down on that orange soil, which I suspect now I will live to see, we'd like to be here to watch it with you. And that's made possible by a small number of people who've been paying for this content over the years and allow us to be together and share this kind of thing with you. So thank you very much for your support, as always. And we'll see you next week here in the land of the free and the home of the brave.